We wanted to start this video differently, but believe me, it's the easiest way to show you the greatness, mysteriousness, and power of ninjas who indeed existed. Forget your memes. In the next few minutes, you will see the truth yourself. We will be accompanied by Shinji Kagawa, a real ninja who lives in a small village Koka, a few hundred miles from Tokyo. It's 1490. Our Shinji lives in the most typical village you can find. People tend sheep, grow rice, and drink sake in the cold evenings, telling stories and playing a very addictive card game, Karuta. But there is something very special about this village. Even the most dangerous criminals are afraid to visit it. Respected leaders of the country sometimes send gifts to Kagawa and his family. That's because the village of Koka is inhabited only by ninjas, including women. Remember we told you in our samurai video about caste system of the medieval Japan. The highest caste was samurai who had the right to kill anybody. Lower on the ladder were merchants, farmers, craftsmen, and other guys. On the bottom were barakumin, the outcast of the Japanese society. But it's not important today. What is important is that ninjas were a unique thing. In the strict feudal times, they didn't belong to any of the castes. Our Shinji Kagawa, just like all his colleagues, lives in a standalone village and can be anyone. The majority of ninjas behaved like usual farmers. Some of them traded as merchants or even impersonated samurais. The most important thing for ninja was his clan. Shinji belongs to the family of Kagawa. The clan, in its turn, belongs to the union of 53 families of Koka. It is named after the village in which a mini-country of samurais lived. Koka exists to this day, and it's a town in which you can live a day as a ninja. However, this service only remotely depicts the real life of ninja. You will be offered to wear a tight costume, throw some shuriken, and finish an obstacle course. In reality, our Shinji, his family and alliance of 53 clans completed far more epic tasks. From the 10th to the 17th century, over a span of 700 years, Japan was a feudal hell. The rulers of different cities and regions fought continuously with each other. Everybody needed an upper hand, something which could help eliminate enemies, make sabotages, and win wars without spilling rivers of blood. Of course, that's what ninjas were all about. That's why they live separately, and no one dared to bother them. To call our Shinji ninja is not completely fair. In those times, such people were called shinobi no mono, or just shinobi. The word ninja comes to us from China. If you read Japanese character shinobi in Chinese, you will have ninja. Chinese spread stories about hired killers, ninjas, and the word became very popular. But to call our Shinji a hired killer is not appropriate. Shinobi is rather an infiltrator. They executed their victims only in the 10% of the cases at best. Most of the time they scouted enemies, stole secret data, burned buildings, poisoned water, and did many other spyish things. The clowns you see in the movies or at ninja festivals bear no resemblance to our Shinji Kagawa. He would crash them in everything, because ninja is not someone you become, it's someone you born. The parents of Kagawa started to train his son very early. They would hang the basket with their toddler, so he would swing and beat against the walls, of course without any damage to his brain. They wanted to train a reflex. Sooner or later the baby started to tuck itself up to avoid injuries. Then they would twist and roll him in all directions. After thousands of bruises, the child learned to fall without breaking any bones or fingers. Then they proceeded to the next step. The focus wasn't on Spartan exercises. First of all, they read books, learned art and science. Ninjas had to know everything and be able to build a bomb from sticks and rocks. Shinji, as all other shinobis, knew chemistry, read all maps, could decipher documents, and was a good actor. A merchant, a peasant, a samurai, and even a general. Ninja could play any role to achieve his goals. That's why modern ninja schools have little to do with real history. Shinobi was a perfect spy, not a warrior. The famous ninjutsu is rather the art of accomplishing your goal than close combat. Yes, certainly they were taught how to fight, but it wasn't the main thing. Why, if you could kill your enemy with a rifle? It was more essential to do other exercises, for example, night vision. A small Shinji was cased into a cave in which he had only a torch, then a candle, then nothing. It was done to get shinobi accustomed to dark. They also trained to run because it's much easier to confuse your enemy and escape. There was a special exercise in which a young ninja was given a head. Shinobi had to put the head on his chest and run. If the airflow kept the head in place, it meant that this person had mastered his moments. The most widespread stereotype, though, is ninja's clothing. And in 90% of the missions, Shinji looked like a usual peasant. No black costumes and katanas. Katana wasn't used at all. It attracted too much attention. They were carried by samurais, so it could raise many questions. The favorite weapon of Shinji is kusarigama. It's a metal chain with a heavy iron weight, which can be used to cut off any limb, including head. What Shinobi enjoyed the most is that folded it looked like a peasant's sickle. Wars were a usual thing, so everyone was inspected at the gates of town. A poor peasant didn't raise many questions. Those black costumes were not used. It's silly because it doesn't help you to hide yourself in the dark. The ninja's costumes were brown, ash or dark gray. These colors can help you to hide in the night. The same goes for shuriken. They were used only by some clans. The main tactic of ninjas was rationality. They used everything technology could bring. Rifles, knuckles and other modern technologies. Shinobi learned all fighting techniques they could, but only to know them. In reality, they most often attacked from behind, confused their enemies and poisoned them. Modern karate ninjas with their dances wouldn't survive in such combat a minute. 200 days of the year, our Shinji trained and lived as a usual farmer. A European citizen of the age wouldn't understand what village he has stumbled upon, but the locals knew where to find them. It was easy to make a deal. For example, Tokyo feudal lord Song Kinmin is getting prepared for the war with Tokifusa Kuba from Fuji. Rumor has it that the army of Fuji is 3 times bigger than his own. Song sighs and sends a delegation to our village of Koka. The delegation looks rather like an armored train with gold. Upon arriving in town, they give gifts to respected ninjas and ask for their help. Ninjas appreciate the gifts, and our Shinji is being called for briefing. Ninjas have a plan to start a rumor that the forces of nature help Tokyo's feudal lord and that there is no sense to go into war with them. Shinji packs his stuff and goes to Fuji. The city looks rather like a fort, but guards don't look twice at a poor peasant with a straw hat and a sickle on his back. He just needs a safe place to stay for a night. So our Shinji easily gets inside. There he settles in a peasant bunkhouse with 100 of people with whom he discusses rice harvest. Then he uses a black powder to start a horrible fire in the town. He explains to peasants that his brother, who lives in Tokyo, has told him that Song Hongmin converses with the elements of nature and that it's only a beginning. The peasants start to talk about it across the town, while Shinji continues to do nasty things. He kills an arms dealer and impersonates him to get into samurai's camp. There he learns the names of the commanders, where they live and other details. He continues to spread rumors about almighty Tokians. Then he kills a few ninjas of the clan Iga, who work for Fuji, and gets into the house of a local warlord. He steals all the plans and information about the army and provision. Now he soaks the clothes of some general to put it on fire during his public speech with a matchstick, fired by a reed pipe. Voila! Everybody sees the general getting on fire and dying a horrible death. The leader of Kubo suspects that it's the work of samurai, but his town is afraid of Tokyo. Now the army is demoralized. No way he can start a war. Even if he finds strength to do so, Shinji has documents and maps that will help Tokyo to conquer the enemy. It sounds like a James Bond movie, right? But in reality, that's how a typical day of Shinobi looked like. Ninjas were not ancient karate warriors. They were ancient super spies who spread rumors, made sabotages, and set their victims up in a variety of ways. They were far ahead of the time. While samurais learned their Bushido, Shinobi didn't care about honor. Ninja saw his mission only, and his death was considered a failure. What's the use from Shinji's death if he wouldn't get important information? Even the legend that ninjas walked on the water is true. Some guys designed water skis by attaching pedals from bulrush. If you really try, you can slide on the water, and Shinobi successfully used the trick. However, the fantasies about ritual killings is a pure mystification. If Shinji declined his task, he wouldn't be punished. Ninjas avoided dangerous missions. A ninja could be killed only if he would leave his clan or disclose their secrets to common folk. In such a case, other shinobi had to punish the criminal themselves. Ironically, ninjas helped Shogun Tokugawa to unite Japan under his rule. In the absence of feudal conflicts, by 1620, there was no need in them. Also, Tokugawa did everything to destroy ninjas' reputation. they were publicly killed, set on fire, and driven underground. Those who survived started doing legal activities and used their skills in trade, agriculture, and other areas. Their books were burned. Only theatrical plays depicting ninjas survived. By the way, guys who changed decorations during the plays wore these famous dark costumes to stay invisible to the audience. It served as a prototype for the costumes we see today in the movies. The teachings of the ninjas died. Not a single modern school of Japan can prove that it ascends from those hardcore super spies. However, it doesn't prove they don't exist. The very idea of ninjas consists in hiding the fact of their existence. Right? See you soon, my friends.